Today, we're going to create a star trails image using a software called StarStaX. And we're going to do it in four easy steps. Three of those steps are required, and the fourth one is optional. It's actually the second step, but let's take a look at what the steps are. So the first step is take the pictures. Whether you're using your cell phone, a DSLR, or any other kind of camera, we need to be able to capture those pictures. I'll go over my equipment and my settings when we get to step one. Step two is the optional step where if you're taking the images in raw format, you need to be able to convert them into a format that StarStaX will like, such as JPEG or PNG or TIFF files. Since I'll be using a DSLR, this is a necessary step for me because I save all of my files in raw. Third step is the easiest of all, which is download and install StarStaX. I'll show you where to get it and how to install it. It's very straightforward. And the fourth and final step is to add all of your images into StarStaX and press one button, and it should do the rest for you. So let's get to step one. Take the pictures. You can do this with any camera and point it anywhere in the sky. Most of the star trails images that we see out in the internet is pointing at either one of the poles because we get a really pleasing circular view of the star trails. But in reality, you can point it anywhere in the sky and the stars will trail because the Earth is rotating everywhere. Whether you're using a phone or a DSLR, it is recommended that you use a tripod and some kind of intervalometer, whether that intervalometer is built into the camera or using a hardware intervalometer like this one here from Newer that I've been using for about a decade now. As for my setup, I'm using a Canon T5i DSLR. It's a stock DSLR, nothing special about it. And if you're using a camera with an interchangeable lens like I am with my DSLR, it's recommended that you go wide when it comes to the lenses. I am using the Samyang 14mm f2.8 wide angle lens. It is my Milky Way lens as well as my Star Trails lens. I step it up to f3.2. For capture settings, you may want to do some test exposures to see what works for you, for your camera and your location. If you're in a really bright area, you may want to do shorter exposures, maybe middle ISO, and see how the stars come out. For my settings, I'm using ISO 800. I took 15 second exposures controlled with my intervalometer, and I took more than 1,000 pictures, totaling more than 4 hours. And all my images were taken from a friend's backyard near Hartford, Connecticut. Let's get to step two, which is optional and is only required if you're saving your images in RAW. So here I have all of my images from Connecticut in .cr2 format. You can see that some of them have clouds, so I'm going to exclude all of them. I'm going to take them from about 6,500 here, and I'm going to put all of these into Lightroom. All right, so we're in Lightroom here and I opened the first image here. You can clearly see the Big Dipper here. Looks pretty cool. And I have all 1,000 something frames here. And I actually went through all of them and took out as many frames with airplanes as possible. And while I'm here, as I said, I'm going to do a slight adjustment to, first I'm going to do it on dehaze. It's right here. I'm going to do about 20% to make it a little darker. You can click on this eye to see the before and after. I'm going to go down. I'm going to do a little bit of noise reduction since we're not stacking. If I zoom in, you can see that this level of noise reduction is pretty good. Looks like there's a satellite here. And since we're not stacking, we're not averaging out the noise and the signal, so it's okay. And the last thing I'm going to do is, which I did for the Milky Way shot as well, is enabling lens corrections. So it already automatically selected my Samyang 14mm, but if it didn't, you'd click on this to select your make, model, and profile. And I'm pretty happy with just these minor adjustments. I don't need to do anything else. So I'll right-click on this, I'll copy. You can also do Control-C, so I'm going to do Copy Edit Settings. I'm going to go back to this view here, the photo grid. I'll select all using Control A, and then I'll Control V, or you can also right click and do Paste Edit Settings, and it'll copy the three changes I made to all 982 photos. And I'm going to do that. Once that's done, we will export all of this. So once all the images have been applied, I am going to Control A to select all, and you can right click and click on Export. 980 photos, and we'll do export and not select any of the presets. Click export. So when you have this option here, by default, the image type is JPEG. You can also TIFF, DNG, and original settings, which will save it as your RAW format. The dimensions full size will keep it the same dimensions, but I'm going to do custom, and by default, I select 1920 pixels because I want to do a 1080p time-lapse later on. Since the dimensions of my image isn't exactly 16 by 9, the wide side will actually be 1280 pixels, not 1920 or not 1080p. So there will be some cropping, but that's okay. Quality, 100%, keeping everything else the same. File name, I'm going to do custom name. You can also do original name or original or capture date, file name, etc. I'm going to give it a custom name of Star Trails, and I'm going to make sure it starts at number one. And this will help us later on when we do a time lapse in a future video. Everything else will be the same, and I'll click on export 980 photos. So back in my directory, I have all the files exported here. There's a discrepancy of two because I ended up putting in two more images after the export, and so we have 982. If you look at one of them, this is what it looks like, and we're going to open this in StarStaX after we download it. Right, next up, we're going to download StarStaX. You can find the link in the description below. You can also search for StarStaX. It's on Marcus Enzweiler's website here. He is a researcher and faculty member in Germany. And StarStaX is a very simple software. We'll take a look at the UI soon. But you come here, if you scroll down, there are download links for both Mac and Windows. It's pretty straightforward, and there is some tutorials here. You can click on StarStaX tutorial to get a basic understanding of how the UI works. And it also covers how the gap filling mode works, which I won't really be doing because it doesn't fit my my image. But you can read through this and play around with yourself. So once you have this, you will download StarStaX. I'm doing it on Windows, so I'm going to download Windows 64-bit. I already have it downloaded, so I'm going to open up the window. Looking at a large icon. So once you have the zip, you'll extract it. And inside the directory, we have a couple of directories. You keep going in until StarStaX goes in. There is this extra dependency if you need it. I did not need it. So go into StarStaX directory. And then at the very bottom, you have a StarStaX.exe. And once it starts, this is what the UI looks like. So I'll briefly go over this, and then we'll pull in our images and do a very easy Star Trails image. A lot of the options here kind of repeat. Like, for example, this is open images. You can also do file open images. Same with dark frames and save as. So the first three buttons are repeats. Same thing if you go to edit. Start processing is currently grayed out, but preferences is the same as the preferences button on the right side here. So if I click on this, it expands or collapses the preferences menu there. And we'll quickly look at this. We have a couple of blending mode options. By default, it's lighten. Gap filling is another really cool one that you can play with. Darken all the way to average decrease exposure, I'm not really gonna play with. I think they work better if you have registered your images and you're stacking them instead of trying to do a Star Trails. I always have trouble with those, so I'm gonna skip those. There's also a checkbox for comet mode. We'll do a quick of the comet mode later on where the stars look pretty cool. We can also process images in reverse order if you want to do a reverse. Star Trails looks pretty cool in a time lapse if you're doing that. Subtract dark images if you have them. I am not using them. Save after each step is what we'll be doing when we do a time lapse in a future video. In the next tab, images, this is how it'll display here. So smooth is the default. You can also do fast and automatic. That will depend on the size of your images and how much system hardware or how good your hardware is. The background here is for the actual, just the UI. So if I can lighten it, you can see that it just changes that. So just leave it default here. Image saving is when you're saving it. You can use compression if you want. It's the default, and I usually just leave it at the best compression quality anyway. Under general, it's just the UI options, such as the program languages, inverting scrolling, which drives me nuts, so I'll never click on that. Disable info messages, I think it's going to be unhelpful because it just turns it off. If you ever go off the regular settings, you can reset to default to make sure you get you have the default settings, and you can check for updates. StarStaX hasn't updated in a while. The next option we have here is the tools. So the gap filling, this will automatically open up if you use the gap filling model, which will show you where the gaps are, and it'll try and you can mess with the sliders here to fill in the gaps, have a different threshold so that it doesn't affect every bit of light. Again, I'm gonna skip this. And the last option is just a help browser. If you have any questions about what dark frames are, what the blending modes do, you can read more about it here. But anyway, so this is it. We can open up the frames or you can drag and drop, which I'll do. It's easier for me. So select all of them, drag and drop. It loads the first one, you can click on them and it'll open up a preview. I'll close the preferences menu here. The zoom options become available. You can zoom in, zoom out. You can fit to screen or do one-to-one, which will have the exact full resolution of your image. I just do this, and you can check and uncheck of different images here. This is a really good thing to have if you're doing a star trails and you have airplanes that you just want to remove yourself. So I have 982. You can clear images and or click this button to start processing. That's what I'm going to do. And you can see that there's a the UI is changing and it's adding the star trails one by one, and it's giving you a really good preview. It can become really slow depending on how good your hardware is and how big your images are. So one of the reasons I saved it as 1920 by 1280 is so that I can show you this animation live. Otherwise, if you use full image, each image is about 10 megs and it's processing almost 10 gigabytes of data. The StarStaX app works really slowly and takes a really long time. And we'll skip for just a few seconds to see what the final image looks like. So let's speed this up. So that took about 68 seconds to complete, pretty fast. And this is what the final image looks like. You can zoom in and see what it looks like. I do have some gaps, so the gap filling may have done something, but it's not something that I really wanna worry about now. And I did catch a little meteor here, like 95% sure it's a meteor. And this is what it looks like. And this also proves that Polaris is not exactly at the celestial North Pole. So polar lining pointing it exactly at Polaris isn't always perfect. You gotta be a little bit off. Once you have your image, if you're satisfied, click on this little button to save as. I'm just going to my Lightroom directory. I will create a new directory. Go in there, and this is the default it gives. I'll just save it as the default. There you go, it's saved. I'll open this up under save, and I have this. And this is my final image. Looks pretty cool, pretty easy. The StarStaX app is really simple. And as promised, we'll also try out the comet mode. So let's do comet mode. This actually works really well for time lapses. The shortened long trails is will determine how long of a tail the star trails have. If I do a short trail right here, click process, you'll see that it kind of just goes in a circle and it doesn't really have a tail, like very small. So I'm gonna stop this by clicking on this X and I'll go back to a long tail, just like right in the middle, click on this and you'll see that now it's starting to look more like a star trails. But after a short time, they're going to stop growing and it'll look like comets just flying across the sky. And I think this is about the point where it just stopped. It looks pretty cool. It looks really good on a time lapse. We'll turn this into a time lapse as well. And we'll take a look at what the final image looks like. So just quickly, let's quickly go through this one. All right, so that took about 70 seconds to complete, and this is the final image. It'll stop wherever the last image is. If I only had half, it would stop, you know, where probably when the Big Dipper was still showing. It looks pretty cool, so I'm gonna save, go back to my save directory. Saves it as the same image for some reason. We're gonna do a comment mode and save it as JPEG. If I open up my directory, we have another one now. So we have comment mode and not comment mode. Looks pretty cool in my opinion. And these are the two ways of doing star trails with StarStaX. Pretty simple. I hope the steps were pretty easy to follow. If you have any questions about any of this, let me know. Links to StarStaX will be in the description below. I'll also link to my camera and lens used so you can take a look at those as well. Until next time, cheers guys.
Let's go!